Say, why don't you love me like you used to do? How come you treat me like a worn-out shoe? My hair's still curly and my eyes are still blue. Why don't you love me like you used to do?
Country music is America's music. It's America's common man poetry.
I think it's important for my generation and the next generation, anybody who's making music, not only country music, but of any kind, to listen to the past and listen to everything that's been made.
Oh, you've caused me to weep and you've caused me to moan. You've caused me to leave my home.
Anything to do with the past is something to do with what we've all learned, and that has to do with music and holds true there also. Music is just, music is always from the past.
Music planted the seed inside of me. Songs about God and family and making the most simple things. These are my roots, the roots of country.
There's a star-spangled banner waving somewhere in a distant land so many miles away. Only Uncle Sam's great heroes get to go there, where I wish that I could also live someday.
There's no doubt about the fact that country music was diffused throughout the world by U.S. military forces. Yes, the United States armed forces took country music all over the world wherever they went, and not only took it with them, but gained new converts with people who prior to that had never known country music.
The boys from the South were meeting boys from the North. They brought their music and their guitars and their records and their songbooks and said, hey man, you got to hear this. And a lot of the guys from the North had never heard that kind of music because, like I say, it didn't get out that much. When they got away from home, the music brings back memories of home, and it's the kind of thing you want to hear when you're way off someplace and your girlfriend's back home or your wife is back home and mom and dad are, you know, you're missing them.
The war came along in the late 30s, and naturally the economy started to pick up because of the production of war materials and so forth. There became the mixture of people and different cultures and people from different parts of the country. And I think this is the thing that fostered a lot of things, not only country music and baseball and things like that. They were spread around the world that people had never been exposed to these things.
World War II greatly affected country music in that the war songs, some of the biggest hits, came out of World War II and during World War II.
For there is a great destroyer made of fire and flesh and steel, rolling toward the foes of freedom, they'll go down beneath his wheel. There'll be nothing left but vultures to inhabit all that land when our mighty ships and bombers make a graveyard of Japan. There'll be smoke on the water, on the land and the sea, when our army and navy overtakes the enemy. There'll be smoke on the mountains where the heathen gods stay, and the sun that is rising will go down on that day.
Well, when the war was over, there was a different attitude among people. Everybody naturally was glad that the conflict was over and that we would get back to some type of normalcy. But the changes that had happened during that time had a great influence on what people liked, what they did. There'd been many new innovations and things. Television was right on the brink of emerging. Radio was expanding.
That's the crowd to be here. And I am proud. Boy, I tell you right now, this is the friendliest place. Several fellas have looked at me and smiled when I'm laughed right out loud.
Minnie Pearl is possibly the most beloved person that's ever been in the country music business. I think for a number of reasons. First of all, a very intelligent woman, highly educated, but she didn't let that bother her.
My brother come down the road the other morning dragging a log chain on his shoulder. Somebody said, hey, boy, what you doing dragging that chain? Brother said, you ever try pushing one of these things?
she came across as one of the audience. She always did that. They knew that she didn't buy that hat. They knew that that wasn't the way she dressed every day. But they accepted it because they always knew that there was someone in that little town where they lived that reminded them of her.
Minnie Pearl was the first one to encourage me to talk on stage, because I wouldn't open my mouth.
You know, behind me are the Stateside, too. My band for many years. I'm awfully proud of them. If you would, please, would you give them all a big hand? They're gonna work hard for you tonight, the Statesiders.
Minnie said, "Melvin, just be yourself, and they'll either like you or they'll dislike you." And it turned out that they liked me, so Miss Minnie was right.
Hello, everybody out there!
Country music exploded in popularity during the 1940s. A square dance craze erupted, country music parks sprang up, honky-tonks were everywhere, and dozens of country tunes crossed over to the pop charts. Driving the boom was a group of hot new country stars including Pee Wee King, Eddie Arnold, Roy Acuff, Minnie Pearl, Hank Williams, and Red Foley.
Have you ever had the corner of Fourth and Grand, where a little ballroom has a shoe shine stand? People gather around and they clap their hands. He's a great big bundle of joy. He pops the boogie woogie rag, Chattanooga shoe shine boy.
Back in the early 50s, Red Foley was a household word, from hitting up his own Prince Albert smoking tobacco show on radio on the Grand Ole Opry. He was hired away by a group of entrepreneurs from Springfield, Missouri. They decided to do a nationwide television show in the heart of the Ozarks. Saturday night was the Ozark Jubilee, the Red Foley Show, and it was wonderful.
Once again, from the heart of the Ozarks, it's Jubilee USA. Brought to you,
of course, he discovered me, and so I owe him a debt that can never be repaid. He had a show called the Ozark Jubilee out of Springfield, Missouri, which was the forerunner of country network television shows, and believed in undiscovered young talent like myself, whom he let be on the show, and a lot of us became known to the public and became household names because of him. And I feel like he's really gone unrecognized by the music world.
In the early days of country music, like 30s and early 40s, most country music that we would hear was based on freight trains and cornbread and turnip greens and baked beans and the country. And that's, I assume, that's what's established country music as being country.
Well, I left my home down on the rural route. I told my pa I'm going stepping out and get the honky-tonk blues.
During the 1940s, a whole new kind of country music emerged, the emotional, hard-hitting honky-tonk sound, featuring the whine of the steel guitar and a sobbing, crying, moaning vocal style.
During and after the war, as writers like Hank Williams merged into the country music, Hank and a few others discovered that they wanted to hear about the everyday life of love and cheating and getting in trouble and being the wife putting you in the doghouse. Getting a little drunk and going out in a pickup truck and the things which are still prevalent in country music today.
World War II changed country music a lot because the honky-tonk music was very popular during that time. And then Ernest Tubb come along with the electric guitar, and that was a new thing, you know, and that was changing country music quite a bit.
Now, darling, you know I love you well. Love you more than I can ever tell. I thought that you wanted me and always would be mine. But you went and left me here with troubles on my mind. I'm walking the floor over you. I can't sleep a wink, that is true.
My dad's
contributions to country music are so many and so varied. One of the basic things that he contributed, it was sort of a change in style of music when he moved here from Texas. He brought the honky-tonk sound to the Grand Ole Opry and was the first to use an electric guitar.
The act that really changed my life was Ernest Tubb and the Texas Troubadours. They came rolling into the fairgrounds, this big green bus. Decca Records presents Ernest Tubb and the Texas Troubadours, stars of the Grand Ole Opry and the Ernest Tubb Record Shop Midnight Jamboree. And these guys, I watched them at Soundcheck. When showtime came, they transformed. They all got out of that bus and they had on those matching cowboy hats, suits, the ties hanging off their necks, patent leather cowboy boots, the belts matched. The old man came out there and did his bit, flipped that guitar over it and said, "Thanks."
If I don't get no satisfaction from the judge, I'm gonna take it to the FBI as a personal grudge. If they don't give me no consolation, I'm gonna take it to the United Nations. I'm gonna see you be back home in 30 days.
It wasn't so much the way he sounded as the way he expressed himself, and he was a very handsome guy. Carried himself beautifully, and Ernest, all those years, he never changed. He's one of those rare people that you meet during your life that stays the same.
It was just wonderful to be around him. You know how some people, you just feel good when you're around them? That's the way Ernest was for me, and I was always proud.
Well, I learned a lot from Ernest. One particular thing, he said, when you're kind of having a bad night, pick somebody out, one person in the audience. You find one person's enjoying what you're doing and concentrate on that person, and that'll get you through a bad night.
What I learned from him was the joy that an artist can take in his work. He loved what he did as long as he did it, and I feel the same way, and I know he does. We'll be doing this when they throw dirt on us, you know.
Yeah.
Maybe that's what they're doing now.
I tell you about Ernest Tubb. He called me just maybe a couple of weeks before he died. And he knew his band was breaking up. And that time I was using two drummers and two bass players. And he called me to see if I had any room anywhere in my band for any of his guys, because he was trying to place everybody. And I thought that really said a lot for the man.
Why, thank you, Jimmy. In fact, I want you, Jimmy, and all the folks to meet this lovely young lady, because she's our special guest tonight from Virginia.
Wonderful.
Fine recording artist for the Coral People, and her name is Patsy Cline.
Patsy Cline. How are you, Patsy?
Just fine.
Nice to see you. And the bell rings with me now, Ernest. This is the young lady you've been telling us so much about.
Right you are, Jimmy. This is the young lady that I've been bragging about. And, Patsy, I think that you should...
There's been so much written about the people that he's helped. I think everybody is aware of that. He helped... talked the Opry into bringing Hank Williams here. He talked him into bringing Hank Snow to the Opry, and he helped Stonewall and the Louvins and Skeeter Davis and George Jones and the Wilburn Brothers, and it goes on and on. Loretta Lynn.
Ernest Tubb put me on the Ernest Tubb Record Shop and helped me get on the Grand Ole Opry for the first time. He said to me, "Now, hon, I want to tell you something in this business. Tomorrow you may not have a hit record." For 25 years I had records in the charts, so I couldn't complain. And for 25 years, I kept looking for them to flop out of the charts, you know. So one day, Ernest come up to me, and he said, "Well, honey, forget what I said to you."
My dad's relationship with his fans and his fan club was unique, I think. But he made me believe and made me understand that I owe everything to those people that come to those shows and buy those records. I mean, every bite of food you take or every bill you pay is thanks to them. He had a rapport with the fans that I've never seen anybody else have. He could just walk out and look those people in the eye, and they were his. And I have seen him when he was so sick or felt so bad that he could hardly walk. But when that show was over, he went and signed autographs till the last person was gone.
Honky, donkin', honky, donkin', honey, baby. We honking round this town.
What typifies a Texas honky-tonk? I guess the old jukebox that played those songs that people could listen to and dance to. A bar up there with the beer signs behind it and a deer head mounted up there and the casual atmosphere, friendly bartender. Everybody knows everybody. Everybody has a good time.
They used to be really roughhouse places. You expected to see a fight. Honky-tonks back then, we caught the tail end of that where you sing and duck. And I thought it would be really rough. Now honky-tonks are discos.
I'm on a honky-tonk merry-go-round, making every spot in town. Starting out early, coming home late, every night with a brand new date. I'm on
a honky-tonks were the devil's playground, and where man meets woman, woman meets man, you know, because the Bible Belt dancing was sinful. And it was in Texas also. A lot of people didn't want their daughters to be going to those dance halls.
One honky-tonk superstar has been referred to as the Hillbilly Shakespeare. Hank Williams is almost universally acknowledged as the finest country singer-songwriter of all time.
The honky-tonk Hank Williams sound, I'll start with saying heavy backbeat, very heavy backbeat. Not drums, not percussion, but the rhythm guitar was the drum. Hey, good look, dot, do, bop, what, bop, that's it.
Hey, sweet baby, don't you think maybe we could find us a brand new recipe?
When we went to New York City, out of one of the many camera shops, gimmick shops along Times Square, I heard Hank Williams singing Cold, Cold Heart on a radio station or a record they were playing, and I thought, Hank Williams is known on Times Square. I can't believe that.
Hank Williams, I don't guess anybody can define charisma, but what it was, he had it. And I watched him work back in those days, and he just absolutely laid the people out flat. The man just had something that all great stars have, no matter what form of entertainment it might be, and that's the ability to connect with the emotions of the audience. And Hank Williams was the greatest at that.
He was a combination of blues and bluegrass and gospel, and that's what country music is, you know, it's all those things. And he's such a guideline for so many people. I'm friends with George Jones now. George idolized Hank. So George modeled himself after Hank, and everybody modeled herself after George, and it just goes on down the line, you know.
Hank was raised, as you know, down in Montgomery, Alabama. I had quite a hard life. He sold peanuts on the streets and shine shoes.
Country music is white folks' blues. That's what it is. And when you think of the programming and everything and the niche and look what it's done today, blues is bigger than ever. Country programming is bigger than ever. But Daddy was singing about the blues, and Jimmy Rogers was singing about it, and now Clint or whoever is singing about blues.
I got your shoes off of Maxwell. I got your dress off Halston.
Daddy was definitely a blues man, without a doubt. Taught by a black street singer named T-Top. That's where his roots came from. His whole beginning was the blues.
I got a feeling of the blues, oh Lord, since my baby said goodbye. Lord, I don't know what I'll do. All I do is sit and sigh.
I remember hearing Hank Williams the first time I ever heard him. He was singing the lovesick blues, and I'd never heard anything like it. He got five encores, and it changed my life. I just loved the way he sang.
When I heard Hank Williams Sr.'s voice, I always thought, and still do, think it was a very unique voice. I listen to it right now and just marvel at how to me it's so different. It's a longing, it's like a hurt.
Your cheating heart will make you weep. You'll cry and cry and try to sleep.
People would be in a bar room or a tavern, or maybe their mate just left them, or they caught their spouse cheating. And of course, Hank Williams came along and sang, "Your cheating heart will tell on you." And everybody kind of perked up and said, "Ah, she or he's going to get theirs." It was kind of a new day in country music.
The melodies broke away from the Appalachian, you know, thing yeah. that was going on at the time, and pretty much broadened the market. Yeah. And took it on. Yeah.
Tony Bennett and people were doing Cold, Cold Heart and stuff. You know, yeah. I think it was one of the first times that hillbilly songs were being picked up by big pop singers and stuff, you know.
Memory from your lonesome past keeps us so far apart. Why can't I free your doubtful mind and melt your cold, cold heart?
To me, he's just one of the most enduring writers, certainly one of the most prolific writers that we've ever had in this business. And because of that, I think that's why his songs are timeless and that they will last as long as music lasts.
You know, honey, I got a song I wrote just specially for you.
Huh?
Just for you.
What is it?
It's called Hey, Good Lookin'.
Oh.
I thought a lot of Hank, and he thought a lot of my family. He used to visit at our house a lot, and I was a good friend of Audrey's, and... You know, it was hard on us. It just felt like a little part of us went when Hank went.
Hank Williams was found dead in the back of his Cadillac en route to a show on New Year's Day, 1953. In the spirit of his music, he had lived hard and died at age 29 of alcohol and drug use.
Did you ever see a robin weep when the will to live? I'm so lonesome I could cry.
It was so sad, you know, going to Hank Williams' funeral. I think Bill Monroe and myself was the only two on there that weren't drinking. I'd never seen anybody drinking like that going to a funeral.
They had singing, like they had the Jordanaires singing, Red Foley, Webb Pierce, Little Jimmy Dickens, you know, singing at the funeral. All of us who were close to Hank Williams, and certainly Hank himself, did not realize at the time of his death what he had really accomplished. We knew that he was the biggest thing at that time, but within 10 years, he was bigger than he was when he died.
Hank Williams' stardom was the prophecy of what was ahead for country artists in the decades to come. And his tragic death foretold the story for many rock stars who also followed his pattern in the years ahead.
Well, Hank's always singing that.
When you walked up to a jukebox and you slip that nickel in, you can bet your bottom dollar when that record starts to spin, you'll hear a fiddle and a guitar with a honky-tonkin' sound. It's that hillbilly beaver and it's spreading all around.
The new honky-tonk country sound spawned by Ernest Tubb and Hank Williams was picked up by artists like Carl Smith, Webb Pierce, Farron Young, Ray Price, Hank Snow, and Lefty Frizzell.
If you got money, honey, I've got the time to go honky-tonkin' and we're gonna have a time.
Lefty Frizzell was the first guy I ever heard to bring a certain kind of blues into country music. I refer to Lefty Frizzell in my bag of tricks a lot of times. You know, he was, I think, just as necessary as Elvis or Jimmy Rogers.
When I found out that Lefty was probably one of Merle's main influences, at that point I started going down to the record shops and digging up all the records that I could find.
I really think a lot of these kids that are coming up are imitating Lefty Frizzell and Merle Haggard, of course, and I'm sure they're familiar with Merle Haggard, a lot of them, but they probably don't realize, but they're singing a lot like Lefty Frizzell.
Will you go honky-tonkin', mate? Every club in town. We'll go to the park where it's dark. We won't put around.
I really wonder a lot of time when I see these videos and these guys dancing around now, I just wonder if they know that a lot of their style came from some of these folks.
Whisper, dear, hey, the one that I love best. Go, boy, go, love, dear, dear. All you gotta know is bring a lot of great her eyes. When you go, when you get sick, go, go, boy, go. Grip the arms that reach to hold somebody new. Or my yearning heart keeps saying, you're not mine.
I'm gonna go where the lights are bright. I got $5 and it's Saturday night.
Back in the old days when I sang or Whip Pierce sang or Ernest Tubb sang, you knew it was us. We had distinctive styles. But all these kids, they're all on about the same beat together with each other.
There stands the glass that will hide all my fears. That will drown all my tears.
I think Webb Pierce influenced me more than anybody else. There was just this heartfelt crying to his music, you know. There stands the glass, you know, and you just go, it caught your attention and held your attention.
Webb Pierce had a high, high, really country, corny sound. And at that time, was really, that's what was country music was. I sang a little bit more mellow than he did, but what he was doing was happening. He was having hit records, and I wasn't until I kind of really got to singing something like him and Hank Williams. Instead of singing a song like, "Your Cheating Heart," I said, "Your Cheating Heart," you know, and whined it a little bit, and that's the only way you could break into it.
Classic country music to me was people like Webb Pierce and Carl Smith. Carl Smith had that emotional content in his singing.
Come on.
A lot of people today that listen to country music have no idea who these people are.
I think it's real important that young people getting into country music, be it performing or just listening, to be aware of the pioneers and the roots of it all. Back to Lefty Frizzell and Hank Williams and Carl Smith.
So let's make welcome, what do you say, the number one girl country singer, Miss Kitty Wells. Let's get it.
Making believe that you never loved me.
With Kitty Wells, it was just kind of effortless, you know, this lovely young woman singing about heartbreak, and this you could almost feel like she was in her living room. It was very natural.
I think Kitty Wells is affecting as an artist because of the directness of her voice. It's just real unadorned, real simple, real straight ahead. You just believe it.
Songs like How Far Is Heaven, Mommy for a Day, and songs like that, that you could put a lot of feeling into them. In fact, How Far Is Heaven is about a little girl's father dying, and she's told that he's gone to heaven, and she wants to know how far it is to heaven. And so I sing that song. Sometimes you can see people in the audience crying, you know, when you're singing the song. So they, you can tell they're really feeling the song by watching them.
She was the first woman, I guess, to have the really big hits. And when I heard her the first time on the Grand Ole Opry, I thought, oh, if I could just do that. I really wanted to be like her.
Kitty Wells was probably a forerunner of Woman's Lib. Hank Thompson put out a song called Wild Side of Life, which he said, I didn't know God made honky-tonk angels. I think women had enough by then, and Kitty Wells came back with a song. First time a song had been answered. She did. It wasn't God who made Honky Tonk Angels.
It wasn't God who made Honky Tonk Angels. As you said in the words of your song.
I think that The Wild Side of Life and its answer by Kitty Wells was really a turning point in country music. Prior to Kitty's success in recording that answer, it was all built into the perspective of the man's view. When Kitty came along, and she gave a different viewpoint, the woman's viewpoint of it, and it was a big success. And from that point forward, songs reflected both sides of the issue, and it kind of opened the door for the great female vocalists that came along subsequent to that, Patsy Cline, for instance, and Tammy Wynette, and Loretta Lynn, and Reba McEntire, and on down the line. Here you had prominent female vocalists that were able to express their viewpoint along the lines that the male vocalists had done for many years.
We had to work the opera, you know, on Saturday nights most of the time, and we had a matinee in Oklahoma City. So after the opera, well, we had to leave out to go to Oklahoma City, and we had to drive, you know, 80-90 miles an hour, pulling a trailer. And I'd sit there, just grit my teeth. I don't know how I've got any nerves left.
That big eight-wheeler rolling down the track means the two loving daddy ain't coming back, because I'm moving on. I'm rolling on. You were flying too high for my little old sky, so I'm moving on.
Oh, traveling in the 40s was tough. The cars were not air-conditioned. All we knew to do is just get in the car, tie a bass fiddle on top of the car, and let the windows down, and go. Go. Oh, yeah, it was tough.
Riding that one car, you know, with an old bass fiddle tied on top of it. When it got to raining, well, we'd put the bass fiddle inside, so we had five people riding in an automobile with the bass fiddle, and it wasn't too comfortable.
There was no money. Those of us that were in the business were in it because we loved it and we had to do it. It was an obsession. Union scale to go on the road and play one-nighters was $10 a day, and out of that we had to buy our food and clothes.
I'm glad it's easier for those nowadays. I really am, because if it hadn't been, they wouldn't. A lot of them couldn't stand to travel the way we did in a station wagon with a trailer behind it. You know, now they've got the big buses, and I had
the damned old bus.
I love the bus. I got to be where the bus. I knew everything. Where everything of mine was in that bus, because I had my own room. I'd go home and I couldn't find a daggone thing.
People have no idea, you know, it looks like it would be different than what it is. Sometimes it's one of the most exciting ways to live, and then other times it's most confining. It's like being in jail. It's much like having a cell.
Living with six hairy-legged guys on one bus is a real learning experience, but it's also, it's like a marriage. It's actually tighter than a marriage, I think. We know everything about one another.
We've been together for so long now that we kind of know what gets on each other's nerves and what doesn't get on each other's nerves. So the five of us ride this bus by ourselves, so we kind of stay out of each other's way. You know, it's been almost 14 years now, so we kind of enjoy it out here and have a good time.
We're in a very weird area.
Somebody said the other day, said, what are you going to do with that bus when it's all over? I said, well, I don't know if I'm going to wait till it's all over or not, but I've been thinking about hiring one of them big old helicopters and taking it up about 5,000 feet and dropping it. Way too long. I'm through with you, too bad your blue, keep moving on.
It's a big job just getting by with nine kids and a wife. But I've been working, man, dang near all my life, and I'll keep on working as long as my two hands are fit to use. I'll drink my beer in a tavern, sing a little bit of these working man blues.
The working people in this country, I think, have supported Merle Haggard. And I was probably 10 number one songs into my career before I realized just how much they were really supporters.
By the late 1950s, honky-tonk music was country's dominant style, and it continued to thrive in the 1960s, thanks to performers like George Jones, Charlie Pride, Buck Owens, and the legendary Merle Haggard.
I think Merle Haggard is a consummate artist and musician. It's about music. It's not about the music business. When a lot of us roosters get thinking we're something after 8 or 9 top 10 records, we should all look over our shoulder and bow to Mr. Haggard.
From a Dust Bowl background in San Quentin prison before age 21, Merle Haggard rose to become the man behind 102 country hits between 1963 and 1990.
There was never a voice like that. It was so much feeling, I think. It was just, he had the whole package. Even had the name. Merle Haggard is a great country name. That's a country star.
My favorite has always been Merle Haggard as a singer. He's got that pure, you know, kind of unpushed natural vocal delivery that's true to a lot of great country singers.
Don't leave me, I cry. Don't take that airplane ride. But you locked me out of your mind and left me standing here behind. Silver wings.
Haggard was such a big influence on my vocal style, and I think you can hear him in so many of us today. It's great to see him finally get some of the recognition that he deserves.
I have a little list here of... There's something emotional about country music, or at least there was. I'm a little worried about that part of country music. I don't hear enough emotion. I hear a lot of people in tune, and I hear a lot of perfect records, but I don't hear a lot of emotion. I wish we could get a little more emotion back in it. But what was your question again?
In Merle's book, Sing Me Back Home, he used to hobo, you know, jump on trains to go see Lefty Frizzell. So I got this big idea. Well, I'm young, I want to go on a big adventure. I'm going to go out to California and meet Merle Haggard, you know, and tell him I'm a singer. Maybe he'll help discover me, you know. I snuck on the train, and the train took off, and I had this big lump in my throat, you know. I'm off to California, I'm going. The freight train went 3 miles to the other side of the town and unloaded their lumber, and then 3 miles back to the other side of town. And that freight trains, they don't go cross country anymore. I didn't know that. And that I told Haggard that story when I got a chance to work with him this year, and I'd never seen him laugh so hard.
Taking you away, leaving me lonely, silver wings, slowly fading out of sight. Slowly fading out of sight.
The music I was first around was always acoustic music. Right about in the mid-40s, I began to see and hear an electric guitar. You know, it had this bite to it. And I really think that that's what I liked. I liked that so much.
Buck Owens was one of the most influential, you know, artists of our time, and how he purposely mixed the guitar up real tinny sounding and real high to make it jump off the radio.
Both Buck Owens and Merle Haggard worked out of the Central California agricultural basin. Their success was so overwhelming that people began referring to them as the core of the Bakersfield sound, a rival to the Nashville music business of the 1960s.
There was a refreshing sound from the West Coast, and I think it was brighter and maybe happier. The Nashville sound had a lot of bottom to it, a lot of bass. And then if you put on Tiger by the Tail, it doesn't sound like it has any bass at all, but it cut through like a knife on the radio. In other words, it was a great car radio record. I've got a tiger
by the tail. AM radio, you know, it was such a terrible system for playing music. The bass would just rumble over everything. So I cut down on the bass and cut up on the high end, and a lot of the guys in those days did too.
The Bakersfield sound, it was just a bunch of really good studio musicians. There was a lot of country talent in Bakersfield, because whenever they migrated out there from Oklahoma and Texas and places like that, they landed in Bakersfield. No more loneliness, only happiness.
Life's gonna live here again. Hey, why not?
I think one of the most exciting sounds in music is Buck Owens, those records that he made in Bakersfield when he was recording with Don Rich on lead guitar and the harmony singing. I mean, it's so exciting. I'd put it up against just about anything. I hear bells ringing, birds are singing, love's gonna live here again. And I hear bees are humming, well I know the days are coming. Love's gonna live here again.
The only way that I can describe what I call real country music, honky-tonk music, go get you some old George Jones records from the 50s on up to now, and the Merle Haggard stuff from the 60s. That, to me, is real country music.
A lot of songs that I grew up playing, you know, because I was working in clubs around Beaumont, Texas. The one-person songs you had to know all of them were George Jones. You had to know everything that he ever did in order to work in clubs in Beaumont, because he was from there. And so I did this one four or five times every night. It was like this. Two, all one, two, three. Well, in North Carolina, way back in the hills, lived my old pappy. It pass it around. Mighty, mighty pleasing. Pappy's gonna screen him. Ooh, white lightning. Yeah, the G-Man, T-Man, revenue's due. Searching for the place where he made his boo. They were looking, trying to book it. Pappy kept a cooking. Ooh, white lightning.
I believe that George Jones is probably one of the most naturally gifted singers of all times. I've seen him do things that I've never seen another singer even try to do.
The way George Jones phrases, there's no other person that can phrase that way. I just feel like, you know, he could definitely just bring me to my knees. Every time I'd hear him sing something like, "He Stopped Loving Her Today." He stopped loving her today. They placed a rip upon his door.
loving heart today.
He's a true stylist. He's like nobody else. Very much in the same way that mountain people sing from their heart, from their gut, from their soul. I think George does that.
If I didn't know who he was, I would think he worked at the gas station down the street, you know. I recently got to do a duet with him. My voice is on there first. And I said, boy, that sounds pretty good, you know. I was pretty proud of that. And then the next verse, George came in. I'm like, man, he just got that natural tone. You can't compete with him, and he's classic.
Who's gonna fill their shoes? Who's gonna stand the tone? Who's gonna play the opera and the Wabash Cannonball? Yes, I wonder who's gonna fill their shoes.